Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Brookings. Delighted to see so many of you on a Monday morning, which is unexpected, as I was hearing Dominique talking about it. But, you know, Washington is always up and running. And on behalf of the Foreign Policy Program and the Center on United States and Europe in particular, I'm delighted to introduce our guests for a long overdue event on Islam in France at Brookings. And I thank the Institut Montaigne for that and his director, Laurent Bigorne, who is sitting here with us. And this has been made possible by the publication of that report here, A French Islam is Possible, which you will find outside if there are still copies available. But you'll also find it online in French and indeed in English. There's also an executive summary for those who want to have the shorter version. I also want to thank Andy Moffat of CUSE, who has made this event possible and who's going to be with us a bit later. But before we start, let me say, of course, that France is a particular case, as its Muslim population is probably the largest in the West. But as we'll find out, there's no precise figure, as the French Constitution does not allow specific religious identification in this relationship between the French state and France's Muslim community, a relationship somewhat different from cases in the US, in the UK, or in Germany. Secondly, France has been, of course, subject to a considerable wave of violent terrorist attacks for the past 2.5 years, but even longer than that, if you recall events in the 90s and in 2012, Mohamed Merah, and also the issue of the veil has been well reported, including in this country, and well, I'm sure we'll address this in a minute, as well as the issue of the burkini last summer. But one thing that we'll try to find out today is whether there's a specific French issue as opposed to the UK, which has also been targeted by jihadist terrorists just a few days ago, but also Belgium, Germany, and even the US. And just like in most of these countries, there are two Muslim groups in France. One that is practicing its religion and faces no conflict with French societal norms, and the other one, a minority drawn to fundamentalism, using Islam as a form of rebellion. Just one figure that you'll find in the report, only 29% of the people interviewed in this survey said they made a weekly visit to a mosque. It's worth saying that a majority of French Muslims are born in France, and three-quarters of them are French nationals. A majority of them are blue collars or employees, but contrary to a somewhat distorted view, there is also a new well-educated elite emerging. All these groups will play a role in less than 4 weeks when the French electorate goes to the polls for the first round of the French presidential election. And one question I hope we can address is whether there's a Muslim vote in France. At Brookings, we don't specialize on Islam and Europe, but we have respected scholars on Islam and the Muslim world. And I should say that this event is co-hosted by the Brookings Project on U.S. relations with the Islamic world, which is represented here by my colleague Shadi Hamid, who has written extensively on Islamic identity, Islamic movements, and US policy towards political Islam, a subject that has become almost as common here as in Europe. Shadi is the author of a new book, Islamic Exceptionalism: How the Struggle Over Islam is Reshaping the World, which is shortlisted for the 2017 Lionel Gelber Prize. Shadi will bring a US perspective to our debate, and I hope a critical view on how France should handle its Muslim minority. Other panelists Dominique Moïsi needs no introduction, but he's the senior counselor at the Institut Montaigne, the co-founder of IFRI, the French Institute of International Relations, author of many books, including the world-renowned Geopolitics of Emotion, How Cultures of Fear, Humiliation, and Hope Are Reshaping the World, translated in 15 languages. Dominique has been teaching geopolitics at Harvard, King's College London, and the College of Europe in Warsaw. And finally, Hakim El Karoui, the lead author of this report, French Islam is Possible, a geographer by training, served in the Prime Minister's office, and has worked as an investment banker and a consultant, but he's also a writer, an intellectual, and the author of several essays. And he's also the founder of several NGOs, including the 21st Century Club, which promotes integration of second and third generation immigrants in France. So without further ado, I'll just give the floor to Hakim for a short presentation of the report, and then we'll have a discussion, and then I'll open the floor for Q&A. Hakim.
Thank you, Philippe. Thank you all. As you said, I've been actively engaged in diversity issues for over 15 years right now, as founder of the NGO Club 21e Siècle. And during all these years, I've had decided to always follow one rule: never get involved in religious issues. Never. For the NGO, which gathers Muslims and non-Muslims, and for myself, because from my point of view, religion is a purely private matter. That's all changed since one cold January day in 2015, Charlie Hebdo, and all the jihadist attacks which followed. I thought it's just impossible for people like me not to do something. Islam is no longer a private matter. Islam is a political matter. And French Muslims must act. So I'm talking to you both as an intellectual and both as a French Muslim. So I go to the Institut Montaigne, I met Laurent, and I knew the Institute, their involvement in social cohesion matters, and I told him we must work on it. And working on Islam means measuring the situation, because there are a lot of people who are talking about Islam with no figures and a very strong representation of the reality. So we made this survey, this report, which is possible according to the French law. And we try to understand, too, the ideological landscape. What is the market share of Daesh? What is the market share of the Muslim Brotherhood? What is the market share of secularized Islam? It's a great issue for us because we have to know to understand the reality. And third, of course, we have to design solutions, both for the government and both for the Muslims themselves. Because I think, this is my core message, I think we can act, not only talk, we can act. And it's not the subject of the Arab, the subject of the Muslims, it's our subject of for all of us, the French, the European, the Westerners. So what is the reality today? Muslims in France, when you ask French people how much Muslim is there in the French population, they tell you 30%. 30%. The reality is only 6%. We launched a bid to perform the survey, which was IFOP. The survey was done by phone. We called over 15,000 people to find 1,000 Muslims. What is a Muslim? A Muslim is a people who says, I'm Muslim. But are you Muslim if your parents are? If your parents were? It matters because we need to understand who is Muslim in France today, but also who was, but no longer practice Islam, and who wasn't, but has converted to Islam. Here's what we learn. About half of the French population, 15 and over, identify as Catholic. 40 says, we have no religion. 6.5% says, we are Muslim. 2 Protestant and 1 Jewish. There are 3 surprises in these results. So there are only 4.2 to 4.5 Muslims in France, and not 6 million, or 10, or 15. There are twice as many people living in Islam than entering Islam, converted people. Twice as many people. And 75% of Muslims are French national, with a half French born. So there is no big replacement of Christian people by Muslim people, nor an incredible attraction for Islam within the French population. This is the first takeaway. Second takeaway, it's not an issue for foreigners only. It's a French issue, it's a French reality, it's a European reality. When we go through demographics, we can see one key finding. Muslim people are much younger than the rest of the population. The average age in France is around 48. For the Muslims, it's around 65. And you don't have 6% of the population under 25, you have 10. So there is a generation gap. Second gap, inside the Muslim group, a social gap. Muslims are more educated and probably richer than we think. 10% of Muslims in France have a master's degree or higher. A third of all Muslims in France have completed 2 years of post-high school education. And 5% of them are management level employees, against 9% for the rest of the population. What does it mean? It means that we do have, right now, in France, a French Muslim elite. And we do have a growing Muslim middle class. And at the same time, we have a Muslim, not only working class, but a Muslim not working class. This is another takeaway of our survey. These people are inactive, unemployed. About 30% of all French Muslims above 18 are not part of the French labor market. Who are they? 2 categories. Women, housewives, we know them, and much more complicated, young people. Some are graduates, but most of them are high school dropouts. 30% of 6% of Muslims in France do not work, are totally inactive. It means 2% of the French population is out of the society. And there is a huge gap within the Muslim population. When we have a look to geography now, we have this map, which explains a mistake about the 30% of the population which could be Muslims. Muslims in France are not spread out all over France. They are highly concentrated in very specific areas. The north, the Île-de-France, Paris and its region, Lyon, the south of France, and Alsace, Bordeaux, et Toulouse. What does it mean? It means that when you have 6% of the population on only a quarter of the territory, when you have, for the population under 25, not 6%, but 10 on the same quarter of the territory. It means that in a lot of suburbs, you have not 20, 30, 40, 50, but 60 to 70% of the young population, which is Muslim. As this population has a lot of problems, and we have a lot of them in prison, in jails, the representation of the subject is, of course, very far from the reality. Now, when we have a look on their faith and religious behaviors, we have several issues, several ideas. First of all, there is no Muslim community in France. No feeling of being Muslim and being part of a religious community. When we ask them, would you vote for a Muslim because he's Muslim? Only 15% says yes. Are you part of a Muslim organization? Only 5% says yes. But on the same times, we have a very observant population, much more than Catholic population. Around two-thirds, 70%, 75% says we are eating halal, we don't drink alcohol, we don't eat pork, etc. The Catholic, only 5% in France of the Catholic groups go to church. And to another takeaway is that when we try to understand what is the penetrations of Islamist behaviors, we can measure it through the veil and the halal food. Halal food is not mandatory according to the Quran. You have to eat food from the people of the book, the Jews and the Christians. It's possible. But the Islamist group said, no, it's impossible because we have to be pure. We have to be separated from the rest of the population. Nowadays in France, 70% of the Muslim population, they eat only halal food. 83% says we want halal food at school for our children. Regarding the veil, it's more or less the same situation. Two-thirds of the population says we are favorable of the veil for the women, even if only a third of the women wears the veil. So we can see a huge penetration, not only of observant behaviors, but of observant behaviors following Islamist rules. Now we can go through the typology. What we can see. We have group one and group two. We can gather them. It's around a half of the Muslim population. They are on the way of secularization. The only difference with the rest of the population is the level of observance. We have another group, around 20 to 25%. They are much more conservative than the rest of the population. They don't understand why sometimes why it's forbidden to express its religion, for example, at work. But, I mean, this group is on the middle. And you have the last group, the rebel Islam, secessionist and authoritarian rigorist. This is, of course, the most problematic group. It is made up of Muslims who have adopted a system of value clearly opposed to those of the French state. One of two people from this group considers Islamic rules and law more important than French rules. 70% have favorable opinions about women wearing not the veil, but the niqab. 35% don't understand why polygamy is prohibited in France. And only a half feel that French secularism allows them to live their faith fully and freely. Who composed this group? Very young people, a half of people under 25, living in the suburbs, and very often with low educated. This is the group which is at stake. In this group, with a mix of violence, rebellion, and behaviors against the society, you will find the terrorists. Of course, not 28% of the French Muslim population is terrorist, but you will find terrorists in this group. How can we interpret the situation? First, let's have a look on the French integration model and its impact on Islam, because it's a quite challenging model. It's based on a paradox. On the one hand, you have a sweet and sometimes a hard oppression of the majority on the minority. You have to be like us. You have as fast as possible, and there is no alternative. It's an order. Be like us. Us, the French. And at the same time, the French model says, if you look like us, then you will be part of us. The proof is that we will give you our daughters to marry. France has the highest percentage of interracial marriages all over the Western world. Much, much higher than in the US between blacks and whites. Around 25 to 30 women with North African origin lives with non-Muslim men. Even if it's strictly forbidden by Islam and by Arabic culture, the figures is very high. We are at the heart of the French paradox. Xenophobia on the one hand, openness on the other hand. Why do French people are so angry against the veil? Because they interpret the headscarf as a contestation of the equality between men and women. And if there are big difference between men and women, for them it means that universality does not exist. And universality, this is a French challenge. So a young French woman who wears a veil contests the French project of global equality between men and women. Therefore, the French intolerance for the veil is not a surprise. We can go through three more explanations, and I don't want to be too much longer. First, there is a challenge for identity for young French people with North African origin. Knowing that North Africa is around 3 out of 4 parts of the French Muslim, we have 10 from Sub-Saharan Africa and 10 from Turkey. When you ask French people, are French people of North African origin just as French as the French? 30% says no. They are not French like the rest of the French. L'Institut Montaigne performs another survey about discriminations. If you have a first name, a Muslim first name, with exactly the same resume than a people who would have a Christian first name, you have 4 to 5 times less likely to get to the next stage. 4 to 5 times less. If you have a Jewish first name, you have 2 times less. You are not the same with the Christian first name and the Jewish first name. People with North African origin, they are not really considered as French. If you make the links with what I said earlier, the sweet oppression, you understand the situation. Until you are not like the rest of the French, you will be oppressed. You will be you will suffer from discrimination. And of course, these people, they are no longer from their country of origin. No longer. They are not Algerian, Moroccan, Tunisian. So who are they? They are Muslim. And they are not Muslims with the same religion as their fathers. Why? Because their fathers, they feel that they have been humiliated by colonization, by their economic, by poverty, by their job. If they have been humiliated, their Islam will be different. And what kind of Islam will they choose? the Islam which is pushed by Islamists, with a level of rebellion, with a level of identities, affirmation, specificity, veil, halal, a number of behaviors against the general value of the French society. This is normal. So this is really the challenge for identity. Second explanation is we have to look at anthropology, the very fundamental organization of the North African family. The North African family is based on two or three realities. First, endogamy. Traditionally, North African family, they used to marry their cousin. A son used to marry his cousin. Second characteristic, inequality between men and women. Nowadays, in the most advanced country in the Arab world, Tunisia, a daughter does not inherit a half of what inherits a son. There is a fundamental inequality between men and women. In the French system, French girls, in the French school system, French girls succeed much more than French boys. And French girls with North African origin succeed much more than boys of foreign origin. The French society values more girls with North African origin than boys. Girls are seen as victims and boys as a threat. There is inside the family a global turmoil, a path to modernity with a change. The role of the women is changing. And it's changing very, very fast. In the context of this challenging identity, and in the context of Islamist groups pushing their ideology, and in this ideology, of course, men have a very specific role. And it's not a hazard. Islamists is, by a certain way, a response of this global turmoil, which is not specific to France, which is at stake in the rest of the Arab world. The specificity of France is that it's going very, very fast, because France urging the immigrants to be like the other French. So we can discuss after maybe what we could do, but I think it's high time now to stop.
Okay, thank you very much, Hakim. I think that was very helpful to understand what the issues are, and I don't think we hear that sort of presentation very often in Washington, so this is very welcome. And I'll keep my questions for now, and I will turn it over to Shadi, to perhaps give us, first of all, some comments on what we just heard, and maybe a U.S. perspective, perhaps?
Yeah, thanks, Philippe. So let me just first say that I recommend that anyone who is interested in this topic read the paper. I read it last night, and it was very, very thought-provoking, challenging, and also, and this is what I'll talk about, and I guess this is why I'm on the panel, I felt a little bit uncomfortable in certain parts of the report, but that only makes it more worthwhile for more of us as Americans to read a French perspective on this very important question. Now, so while I was reading the report, I really felt like I am really American in the sense that I have just a very different set of starting assumptions when I look at these issues. So it was almost as if I was reading, even as someone who's done, I've thought a lot about these issues in the European context, it still felt very foreign to me. And that was the challenge that I had in reading this report. And just one example, and we'll talk a little bit about the recommendations later, but in the recommendations section of the report, the authors use, Hakim and his team, they use They use the word state, referring to the French state, but they put state in capital letters. And I get I almost felt kind of threatened by that, this idea of a state with capital letters. It's a strong state, and the French state has a very proactive role in managing the French Muslim community and integrating them. And it's not something that's left up to local communities, but it's a very state-centric model of integration, and the French authorities are involved very intimately in questions of religious production. And as someone who's born and raised in the US, this is very much anathema to how I think a lot of us see the role between the American state and local religious communities. So that was interesting. So I think that in having this conversation, we should be very straight up about where we're coming at these issues from, and how I'm certainly not objective, and I should be very forthright with you as the audience, that it's hard for me to read a report like this and be objective to the extent that anyone can really be objective about anything. I'm not sure that I can, and I have to be, I think, self-conscious about that. Now, so a couple more specific things. What's clear, and something that I've written about in the past, and I think this is where we agree, is that we have to speak frankly about the fact that there is a clash of cultures in France between French Muslims and French non-Muslims. Not all of them, and of course it's a very diverse community, but just the polling numbers that we see here, the gap in religious observance is very, very large. And I was actually struck, and if you look at some of the previous polls on French Muslim observance, it's still pretty high, but in some ways the numbers here are even a little bit higher. So it really underscores this point. So for example, 65% of Muslim respondents in France favor the hijab. 28% favor the niqab. Now we can debate what favor means, and I wasn't entirely sure what that means in practice, but to have 28% of Muslims in France favoring the niqab, even though the vast majority wouldn't wear it, I think is a very striking number. The majority of French Muslims seem to try to pray at least a couple times a day, up to five times a day. That's significant. So on and so forth. And there are two issues, again, coming at this as an American Muslim, that are, in my view, very much non-issues here in the U.S., and I was very struck by how much they are two of the three central issues that Hakim underlines in his report. This idea of halal food, I'm like, what is going on here? Well, halal food is an issue, I would say, for American Muslims from the subcontinent. But as speaking now as an Arab Muslim American, growing up in the Arab Muslim community in Pennsylvania, and we had the local mosque, we had Sunday school, so I was part of this scene. I don't have any recollection until I got to college of anyone making halal food an issue. So I don't even understand what's going on here, because what my parents told me is as long as it's not pork, it's halal. Doesn't go to McDonald's, go to wherever you want. This idea that you have to cut, you know, it's changed maybe a little bit in recent years, but that was my own experience. And to this day, most of my Arab friends, Arab Muslim friends, even if they are practicing, even if they are serious, the halal food thing isn't a strong identity marker. Some of them do it, but it's like, yeah, we like eating halal. We go out of our way to find that. But it's not a big deal because no one has a problem with them doing that. So that was one thing. But also the headscarf. Now, it's true that American Muslims tend to live in urban areas which are more liberal and more Democrat as opposed to Republican. But I think in a lot of ways, the headscarf has become, at least in the Trump era, a rallying cry for liberals and Democrats to say, we are with you as American Muslims. We support what you're going through, and that includes women who wear the headscarf. So to be a member of the liberal elite in America today is to go out of your way to like the hijab. Which is interesting. So I was just at the coffee shop the other day on 14th Street, one of the places that I go, and there was like a little picture at the entrance of a woman wearing hijab saying, everyone is welcome. And I can't imagine that coffee shops in France would have that. You know what I mean? So those are two things, I think, which really stood out to me. And we have to ask ourselves, why are these two issues, headscarf and halal food, why do they play such a different discursive role in the French context than they do in the American? Now, I think the big question that underlies a lot of the report in our conversation here today is this question of whether someone can be both fully French and fully Muslim without there being a contradiction, or even forget a contradiction, just a tension. And I think we're all trying to find ways from our own perspectives to limit those contradictions. But I honestly don't know how you get there in a context where the starting assumption in this report is that there is something called French secularism, laïcité, which is the more kind of, let's say, aggressive interpretation of secularism. Sometimes in a French perspective, they'll call it neutrality. So there's different ways to talk about this, right? But I think that for a policy report where you're trying to reach out to French policymakers, obviously you're going to accept that this is the starting point. You're not going to question the basic foundations of French secularism. But what I would argue is, I don't know how we can really make progress, not just in France, but in Europe, and I think also here in the US, unless we can really talk about how do we become more comfortable with public expressions of religiosity. So if a woman is wearing hijab, that shouldn't be seen as a threat to the very foundations of the French state. Because essentially what you're saying to a French Muslim woman who wears hijab, the very fact that you've chosen to wear this piece of cloth means that you are threatening our founding ideology. How would someone feel if that's essentially what's being told to them, either implicitly or explicitly? So really the question for me is, are we able in the French context to at least try to challenge the starting assumptions of laïcité, and to say, is it possible to broaden the conception of laïcité where it becomes more accepting of this 50%, this 40%, however we want to define this group, that is more outwardly practicing? And I also respect that the French majority, because it is a democracy and you have to respect democratic outcomes, the majority of French citizens feel very strongly about laïcité. They don't want to get rid of it. They don't want to question it. They don't necessarily want to broaden it in a significant way. So if that's what the majority of French voters believe in, then we also have to respect that that's very important to their self-conception. So I'm also not comfortable telling the majority of French voters, hey, you guys are doing it wrong. You have to have a more Anglo-Saxon or American conception of secularism. And that's also my bias. I really believe in the American model. But is that because I'm objective or because I'm a product of that American model? So that complicates it a lot. And I'll end there, and that I just wanted to sort of offer some provocations for discussion. I don't think that I can really offer a solution to this problem. And that's why I think that is why it's such a challenging conversation, is because deep down I'm not sure there is a solution to the problem.
Thank you very much, Shadi. That's very helpful. Just three very quick points. I think first, in the US, it's only about 1% of the total population that is Muslim versus, as we heard, 5, 6%. Some people say more, but it's probably not more than 6%, according to Hakim's figures. Secondly, it is true that the laïcité concept is working, but mainly in public space. In sort of state schools and not in private environments, not in private schools, and that's something people sometimes forget here. And thirdly, and then I'll turn to Dominique. I think your first point was really interesting about the state, the state managing Islam or managing religion. Well, in fact, there is a clear separation in France between the state and religions, all of them, for a long time. But as you know, France is a very centralist country, unlike the United States, which is a federalist country. And the fact that you have 50 states and the territory is much more massive makes it a very different system altogether. And of course, the history of the two countries is hard to compare. But let me turn to Dominique Moïsi. Glad to have you here. How can we put that in a sort of broader political context in Europe in particular? And one question I'm really wondering whether this group or these groups perhaps will turn into voters on April 23rd and May 2nd, May 7th, the two rounds of the French presidential election.
Well, first, I find quite ironic that I should be concluding the debate. I come from a different background. And in fact, I arrived yesterday in Washington with Hakim, and there was some nervousness about the issue of visa in the new Trump America. So we decided to enter together the United States. And the policeman in charge says, "Are you family?" And I said, "No, but we are good colleagues." And in fact, it's a joke, but it's a very serious one, because it places the accent on a word that has not been used so far, which I think is key to the problem of Muslims in France. And it's the word fraternity. A French Jew and a French Muslim came together as family and entered together the United States of America. And I found it as quite a strong symbol. I've been working, Philippe said that, for a long time now on the issue of emotions. And initially working on the meeting between the culture of humiliation and the culture of fear. And if you look at the specificity of the situation of the Muslim community in France, it looks like another illustration of the encounter between humiliation and fear. There's probably more fear in France than in many Western countries, and there's probably more humiliation in the French Muslim communities than in many others. And if you want to understand those two specificities, there's one word I used, fraternity, which is so much placed ahead. We are the land of liberty, equality, and so little fraternity, unfortunately. Then there is the issue of laicity, which cannot be translated into English simply by the word strong secularism, because to some extent, laicity is the fourth religion of France. You have Christianity, you have Islam, you have Judaism, and you have laicity, which tends to present itself nearly in a religious manner. And I think it explains why an Anglo-Saxon is so surprised. And then there is history. And history is, in the specific case of France's relation with its Muslim, the history of the Algerian War, which has never been faced properly, never transcended properly. And when you see in the electoral campaign the candidate of hope, Emmanuel Macron, touching on the issue of colonization as a crime against humanity, which may be described as that, but doing so in Algeria, in front of the Algerian president, could only be received in the most negative manner. And I think if you add all these elements, they're constituting pillars of interpretation behind what I found as an extremely fair, subtle, and objective study done by Hakim and the Institut Montaigne on this subject. Now, personally, and it may be good that I should conclude this debate, because I was the product of Harvard University as much as the Sorbonne, I have integrated into my mind some kind of Anglo-Saxon values. When I'm checked at St. Pancras in London by British policewoman wearing a thin, light, elegant veil, I'm not shocked whatsoever. I see that as a declaration of identity. I'm a British citizen, I'm a policewoman, and I happen to be a Muslim. And I am not at all shocked by this demonstration of difference. But it must be because I have been spending too much time in an Anglo-Saxon context. At the same time, and I want to do that balancing exercise, when I hear in the United States neoconservative comments such as Europe is the continent where the churches are empty and the mosques are full, I also resent it because it's so much more complex than that. And this is what I think the plea that Hakim has made is a plea for complexity. And that plea for complexity is a plea for moderation, is a plea for tolerance. Now, to answer your question, because I want to come to it, could we look at the Muslim community in France as the black community in the United States? Is Marine Le Pen going to be elected tomorrow the way Donald Trump was elected yesterday, in part because a lot of the black voters did not mobilize for Hillary Clinton the way they mobilized for Barack Obama? We'll know the answer soon. My intuition is that it's not going to take place that way, for reasons which can be explained as follows. First, Emmanuel Macron is a much better candidate than Hillary Clinton was. In fact, in American terms, you can say that in less than 4 weeks from now, the French will have the choice to vote like the Americans in 2008 or like the American in 2016. And my guess today is that they will vote for the candidate incarnating America in 2008. And this, again, for a combination of hope and fear. They are afraid of the adventure which the National Front could represent. And they are slightly hoping for a better future. And I think the Muslims, the young Muslims, who have integrated into French economic life are going to play that role. And in the figures that you can see in Hakim's report, there are hints, indication that we are going to go in that direction. I think I've spoken too long. I had really no legitimacy whatsoever.
They've let you in. So.
Given, well, I was protected by Hakim.
Well, in fact, the reality is that Hakim did have some worries about his visa. I have to say that officially here. Let's just very quickly go back to the lead author of this report, Hakim. First of all, if you have comments on what Dominique just said and on Hakim, on what Shadi said earlier, and also I'd like you perhaps to give us a few of your policy proposals that are contained in this report. Obviously, I mean, we could go on for perhaps a few more hours on this because I have a long list of questions which we won't have time to cover, and I do want to give you a chance to ask questions for at least the last 20 minutes. But please, Hakim, go ahead and give us some more food for thoughts.
First of all, defining a policy, we must choose a goal. For 34 or 40 years right now, the government, I will explain the role of the government in the Islamic organization in France, the only goal was to have a representative organization. For me, the goal is the battle against Islamism. It's not exactly the same thing. We can imagine a top-down approach and a bottom-up approach. Top-down, it deals with organization and with education. The organization is a bit tricky. In the name of laïcité, everything should be separated. Laïcité is the neutrality of the government. This is the case for all the religions except Islam. For decades now, the Minister of Interior is running Islam along with certain Muslims. We need a deep liberalization from the French government, but also from the government of the French Muslims' origin, Algeria, Morocco, and Turkey. Nowadays, Islam is run by Muslim people. Most of them are French, but they are immigrants. Muslim people with very strong ties with their countries of origin, and specifically Morocco and Algeria and Turkey. Our proposal is to cut the tie between French Islam and these countries. Why? Because the agenda of these countries is not France's interest. Their agenda is to control their population and to have an influence on France by controlling this population. Our proposal is to set a new agenda with, on the top of the agenda, fighting against Islamism, and second, organizing Islam with what is the heart of an organization? Money. There is a lot of money around Islamic consumption. Halal food, around 5 billion euros. The market is around 5 billion euros. The business of the pilgrimage, you pay around $1,000 when you go to the pilgrimage to Mecca, only to the travel agency. And travel agencies have strong links with the mosques. And the third business is donations. It's nobody knows what is the amount of money with religious donations, but it's probably more than 10, 15, 20 million euros a year. Today, all this money go to the mosques with strong links with the countries of origin. Our proposal is to cut the tie by setting up a new national organization run by French Muslims, independent French Muslims, I mean, no ties with the country's origin countries, and run by professionals. Today, people in charge, they have very strong tie with their country of origin, and, I mean, they are not professionals. Their professional background is, for most of them, very low. Their business is to run a mosque. And our proposal is to help French, the new elite, I mean, to build a contract between the new French elite, Muslim elite, and people in charge on the local ground to help current people with strong ties with the country's origin to go out. This is a political battle. This is a battle inside Islam, the political battle. And there is another battle, which is not for the organization, which is for the ideology. And this is probably the most important one, because this is not a French one. This is a European one. This is a Western one. Today, who is on the battlefield? Islamists. In front of them, there is no one. Secularized Muslims, they are not on the battlefield. They are in the society. They want to be as integrated as it is possible. We work a lot on the offer of Islam on the net. The results were tremendous. 90% of the traffic to theological sites in French are going to Salafi sites, 90%. Why? Not because they are very powerful or very rich. No, they are the sole player, the only one players, the Salafi. So our idea is the government can do a lot of things. Teaching Arabic. In France, it's quite impossible to learn Arabic in the public school system. Why? Because for social reasons and ideological reasons, the several governments says, no, if you learn Arabic, you will not learn French values. The result is that if you want to learn Arabic, you go to the mosque. You have probably 80,000 to 90,000 young children who learn Arabic in the mosque. In the French public school, you have 8,000. So France decided to send its children to the mosques. We think we have to relaunch Arabic as a very powerful language and as a way to prevent, of course, radicalization. Because if you learn Arabic, you will learn the history, the culture, the anthropology, and you will have intellectual tools to go against Islamism. Second, the chaplain. According to the French law, it's possible for the government to fund the chaplains. But there is no Muslim chaplains. I mean, there are some in the army. Not at school, not in jail, not in the hospitals. They could be real soldiers for French Islam. And the bottom-up approach is probably much more important. We have to build a theology, a French theology, a Western theology, a Western Muslim theology. This is a key point, a very important point, because without the theology, we can go against Islamism. If we have the theology, we have to spread it out on internet with websites, with speakers, with stars, there are a lot of Islamist stars, televangelists. I think you have a lot in the US.
Not Islamists.
Not Islamists.
I don't think.
Christian. But in the Arab world, there are a lot promoted, for example, by major Arabic broadcast, Al Jazeera, NBC, Iqra, Saudi channels. We need to spread out our theology. And we need people on the ground. Because all over the Arab world, how the Islamists did, they spread out their ideology by charity. Social charity, educational charity, etc., etc. And we have the same in France, in our poor suburbs. So, we need a theology, a digital strategy, and people on the ground to spread it. With the help of the government, to have new, to let the newcomers to run Islam.
Thank you. I think this idea of the use of digital is particularly exciting, and I'd love Shadi to comment. I'm sure you have a lot of
just a very
to say,
quick
but
response.
On this in particular, I mean, if you could.
Yeah. So, so my problem in this discussion is that I'm very uncomfortable with this idea of, again, going back to this question of the role of the French state, this idea that France has to create a new westernized or French compatible theology. So why, but I think to myself, why is the French state involved in promoting the correct understanding of Islam? And that's not just because I'm American, but also that is what every single authoritarian Arab regime has done. They say Islamism is the problem, and we are going to have state-appointed clerics and a very managed clerical system, and we're going to enlist those people in this battle against ideas that we don't like. Of course, France is different because it's a democratic country, so there's democratic legitimacy in doing that. But that said, I just wonder if there do we really have any models of Western countries using a state-centric approach to create a more modern understanding of Islam? And even that kind of language is problematic. Why should there be a supposedly liberal, secular, modern understanding of Islam? What if Muslims don't want to believe in that kind of Islam in their particular context? What if they want to be more outwardly religious or more comparable to Christian evangelicals here in the US or Orthodox Jews? It just, I don't know where that starting assumption comes from, but it only comes from this idea that liberalism or secularism is the norm and we take it for granted that everyone else has to do whatever they can to meet that pre-established norm. And we could try that, and it could be an improvement upon what we've had before in France, because obviously, as you lay out in the report, it hasn't gone well up until now, so we have to try something new. That said, I don't have any models that I can point to of Western nations doing this effectively and doing it well. Because when the state is telling you what kind of Islam to believe, there's oftentimes a tendency to say, hey, I want to rebel more against whatever the state is proposing. So that's my general concern. But and it's also interesting that I think, and I don't know if there's any way that we can avoid this, but even I feel like we as Muslims, whether it's in the US or France, we've sort of become an object of other people's debates. We've become a problem to be resolved. That is how we're talked about now. Now, I don't know how else we can talk about it, because in France, it is actually a problem. And no one can deny that. Maybe it's less of a problem in the US, but I feel like this is the future of our debates about Islam and Muslims in the West. We are a problem to be resolved. And I don't know if that can ever really be good in the long run. Now, on the digital side, which you wanted me to comment on, You know, I'm skeptical of a lot of the counter messaging and let's use the internet. And the U.S. is not good at using the internet or Twitter to promote moderate Islam. Like there were some, as some of you know, there were some initiatives where we would tweet inane things. Oh, moderation, fluffy Muslims, stuff like that. So again, like are a bunch of random people in the State Department who unfortunately are maybe very well-intentioned, but don't really know a lot about the Muslim community, are they ever going to be good at designing Twitter campaigns? I'm being a little bit facetious here, but I think that that is also, we have to be aware of that problem as well. Can French state institutions or French-funded institutions actually do a good job on the counter-messaging in the way that we might like?
Okay, just one word. Dominique, you want
to? One word. If you look at the fight against Islamic fundamentalism, as it is in particular incarnated by organizations such as ISIS or Al-Qaeda, three words are coming to mind. The first one is security in the military sense of the term. Raqqa and Mosul, at some point, hopefully within this year, are going to fall. And the idea of the caliphate will collapse with the fall of those two cities. Then you have intelligence, which is a second key word. How do you, through intelligence, make sure that less terrorist attack will come? And then there's the word education. How do you make sure that through education you succeed in integrating those who could one day turn to become terrorists? And those three dimensions are in some way totally intertwined. And because they are intertwined, they justify the centrality of the role of the state. Because if those are elements of integration, who else can really do that, can master the variations on the word security, intelligence, and integration through education? So it doesn't seem so absurd, given the nature of the problem and the combined nature of the answer which we have to give.
On top of the fact that, I mean, anybody who's gone through the U.S. presidential campaign here would have noticed that Islam sounded like a problem as well. It may not be at the community level, but certainly, I mean, Donald Trump made Islam a big issue, which was not the case really before. That's
kind of why I think we're very concerned. I mean, the American Muslim community here is increasingly concerned precisely for that reason. So in some ways, we talk about how the question of integration of American Muslims, there was the pre-Trump era, and now we're entering this new phase where we might change as a community as a result of certain attacks on who we are and our role and so on. But we'll have to wait and see how much that seeps into the broader society. Yeah.
Sure. Okay. Just one word, and then we'll go to the room.
To be precise, we never proposed that the government spread out on its name a new theology. Never. We want the government to step back in the Islamic organization, not only the French government, but the North African governments, step back to let the new French Muslim to run the organization, to organize it, to fund it, with one goal, Islamism. And the bottom-up approach, spreading the ideology, spreading the theology, not in the name of the government, in the name of Muslims, of imam, of theologists, exactly like Islamism do, exactly. So this is not the French government who will promote its Islam. This is the French Muslims. This is completely different, completely.
But the French government...
But we need the help of the French government to cut the ties inside the organization walls and probably to found the ideological battle, because French Muslims, they are not rich. And how do we want to fund this battle outside the government in France? Very complicated.
Okay, I think we've got about 15 minutes, so I will ask you to ask very short questions and real questions, and to please identify yourselves. So the gentleman here, yes, just right here. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Andre Goodfriend. Just a quick question. Can you draw any parallels between the policies you're promoting and, looking back in French history, in the French Enlightenment, the move to the Jewish emancipation, the hope that that would separate and integrate that population more effectively into French society, giving up the traditions of the past, ultimately leading to the Dreyfus Affair and the continued sense of being a separated community, so that looking at a parallel in French history, I'm wondering if there are lessons to be learned from that experience.
We'll take two more. Yeah. Gentlemen here. Yes.
Thank you. Peter Gluck. I've seen several video clips of Marine Le Pen saying that she would ban the hijab. Thank you. If she were elected, I haven't heard her make any reference to the fact that Sikhs and Orthodox Jews also wear head coverings. So is her ban exclusive or inclusive? Thank you.
Okay, last one, gentleman here.
Munji Dawadi from the Center for the Study of Islam and Democracy. Some of the terms are a little bit confusing for me, especially when you started talking about the suggested policies. You were talking indications, for example, about the hijab and the halal food as indication of maybe tendencies or the influence of Islamism. But at the same time, you are suggesting in your policy to kind of have the Muslim elite be the ones who are managing these Islamic organizations and institutions. What would they be advocating for? Like, Muslims don't eat halal and don't wear hijab, and how much credibility that's going to have in Muslims in general?
Okay, so who wants to start? Dominique, do you want to start?
The two first one, very quickly. Marine Le Pen has also suggested that Jews should not wear kippah in public because that would not do well with the rest of French society. And on the first question, enlightenment is teaching us ambivalent lessons because through the philosophy of enlightenment, you wanted to integrate the Jews, but you wanted them to become like others. And so there was forced normalization as well as welcome integration. And this is something which we have to keep in mind. The logic of enlightenment is twofold. You want to integrate the other as long as they become and look like you.
Hakim, or...
I could just say something very quickly before Hakim will probably want to address more.
Is
on the second question about Marine Le Pen, the fact that she's focusing on Muslim religious symbols. So I think that in some ways, French culture is suspicious of all outward expressions of religion. So I think when people make the case, when people, my French friends tell me, Shadi, it's not just about Muslims, it's about anyone who is being very publicly visible in their religious observance, which is true. But the problem or the issue is that it just happens to be the case that in the entirety of Europe, it's Muslims who are more visible with their religious symbolism. And it's also Muslims who are in every single European country, with maybe one or two exceptions, according to the polling we have, who are more practicing than their Christian counterparts, many of whom don't even self-define as Christians. Sorry?
They are more numerous, too. There's a question of
number. No, I mean in per capita, in percentage terms. So in that sense, I can understand why many in the West on the further right, they see Islam as unusually assertive. They see Islam as different, in part because Islam is different in this particular respect. Muslims do seem to be more religiously observant, especially in Europe. So that's why I think it is more in that sense a European problem than a U.S. one, because we can always say, hey, well, there isn't too, like Christian evangelicals, there is something that we can compare with when we try to talk to American audiences and say, well, hey, you know, Muslims might be quite conservative in X, Y, and Z way, but you probably might feel the same way about Christian evangelicals who don't want people to sell cakes to gay couples, right? So that's why I feel like we have to be, even though I'm very critical of it, I also want to make the effort to be understanding of the context that for someone who's an atheist, someone who's suspicious of religion, they will see Islam as a bigger issue because they see Muslims more assertive in their religious identity.
Hakim?
Yeah, to answer your question. The new alliance between the elite and the local managers is not to ban the veil or the halal food. It's to run the cult, to pay the imam. Nowadays, the imam are paid but by foreign countries, or they are not paid at all. The idea is to build mosques and to help imam theologists to do their work, what they have to do. The question around behaviors, it's another challenge. And of course, you can't be in front of people who do believe that veils is mandatory, or that halal food is mandatory. You have to respect it. For me, it's like a market. You have to understand your market. You can be against the market. But it doesn't mean that you don't have to help theologists to think a new Islam, a modern Islam, a liberal Islam.
But this idea of this project of people encouraging a liberal Islam where maybe the idea that would be promoted is that, hey, you don't have to eat halal food, or hey, it's totally fine to not wear hijab. That's fine if Muslims believe that and they have that debate internally. But I guess what I still am having a lot of trouble with is why does a French Islam have to promote the idea that hijab should not be necessarily observed? Like, I just...
Because our French integration model. Mm-hmm. I try to explain. Hijab is seen as a tool, as a sign of inequality between men and women.
But maybe that's the
problem. As a very deep sign of inequality between men and women. And French people, they do reject it.
But maybe
that's a reality.
Maybe that's a problem.
That's a political reality. And we will not change France. We will not.
Okay, but maybe that's a problem that the hijab is viewed as a political tool. I mean, that's a personal decision about what people wear. If they believe that that's how they build a better relationship with God, and it's something very personal to them, you're telling them that what they're wearing is a political tool. Why can't that be questioned? I just want to put... Is it impossible for at least some people in France to question that basic assumption?
But I think the idea is really, it's not for the states to promote one model or the other.
But that's the society.
It's the idea to have a choice between different options. Let's have three more questions. The lady there.
Hi, thank you for this informative panel. My name is Contessa Bourbon from the New York Times. I'd like to ask, what factors have pushed Muslims in France to be radicalized, as evidenced by the attacks in Paris and this in France.
Very good. Gentlemen in the front.
Hi, Leonard Campbell. A number of times the panelists have mentioned, I guess, the comparison between French Muslims and Black Americans. And I'm wondering if when you look at integration and assimilation of, or the attempted immigration and assimilation of Black Americans in society and how that has worked, if you are encouraged by essentially what you're proposing.
The gentleman here.
I was born in Morocco, so I know a lot about Muslim civilization and culture. I have lived in France also for 8 years. In my opinion, there should be a major affirmative action and effort with regard to job. When a Muslim has an interview with IBM France and he says his name is Mohammed, he will not be hired. So a lot of efforts have to be deployed with regard to employment. Number two, a parallel effort should be undertaken to move toward showing the Muslims and other minorities in France that they are loved. I believe in the power of capital L love. If they are loved, if they are welcome, if they are seen as equals, they will not be a Bataclan disaster. They will not be their reactive efforts to say France will become a Muslim in 50 years. Notre Dame de Paris will become the greatest mosque in Europe. So employment, love, and yes, filtering and cleaning of religious documents to remove any anti-Semitism, any calls for jihad and violence, all this will go a long way to improve the situation. Regarding the kippah occupies less space than a hijab or a veil. I have a kippah, it's red. If it were black and much smaller, nobody would see it if I had black hair. So there is a distinction between the veil or the burqa and our minuscule kippah. This one is very visible, I agree. But again, if I had very dark and black hair, you would not see it at all. So Marine Le Pen is wrong to say that veils should be banned as well as the kippah. I think the kippah is less provocative and more innocent and more threatening.
But we can't ask
than the
Muslims to wear kippah. Huh?
Can I wear my kippah?
And just a point of information, I believe that if you look at the Pew Research surveys, that the French actually don't view Islam negatively. I mean, you should really look at the last surveys. They are very clear on that. Compared to other countries in Europe, France is actually one of the least anti-Muslim countries. So. We don't have time anymore, so I'm going to ask Hakim to try to round this up. Perhaps I'll ask if Dominique and Shadi want to say a final word, and then I'll ask Hakim to round up. Dominique, do you have anything to add? Or?
Well, I go back to that issue of the veil and integration, given what France is. I have a slightly different view, personally. You can't accept proclamation that are against French values in the sense that there are signs of violence, of intolerance, of rejection, of difference. But affirmation of your own difference is very different from the fact that you refuse the difference of others. And from that standpoint, have a difficulty to say that the veil is against French identity and culture. What is against French identity and culture is the teaching of hatred, the teaching of violence. This is completely different from my standpoint.
Shadi?
Yeah, so just very quickly on the question of Black identity here in the US, I think the way that we've, at least liberal elites, I can't speak for the rest of the country because do I even know my own country anymore? But in kind of major urban centers, I feel like liberals have gone out of their way to accommodate very affirmative expressions of Hispanic identity, Black identity, Muslim identity. Now, maybe it goes too far and that's the backlash against identity politics, but the way that I think a lot of Americans have dealt with this is by not telling Black Americans or Hispanics that they have to be more like everyone else. It's by saying that at least in the liberal parts of
I live here.
Okay, but I'm that's the whole debate between liberals and conservatives in the US. The idea is that liberals accept that minority groups have their own identities. Now, it's not perfect, but I'm saying it's a very different model. Very rarely do you hear liberal commentators in the New York Times saying that Blacks have to be more like whites. It's very, very rare to hear that kind of discourse. But on the other, I would just maybe pose this to Hakim, and it'll be an ongoing conversation and debate, is this idea of, are French values static or can they evolve? I mean, that's a debate that we have in our own country. What does it mean to be American? And I think that conception of Americanness has always been fluid. And I think that fluidity can sometimes be a good thing, sometimes be a bad thing, but all countries evolve based on changing circumstances. So it seems to me to be a little bit concerning if a country cannot have a national conversation about what it means to be what they are, what it means to be French, what it means to be American. And God knows, the next 8 years in our own country, that is going to be the primary debate that we have as a country. It's not going to be about tax policy or the details of universal health care. It's going to be, what does it mean to be an American?
Shadi, you should run for elections in France. Good luck for that. Hakim, a final word.
I would say the same thing than Shadi. Islam raised a point, a subject. What is a French now? What does it mean to be French now? Could you be French and Muslim? With the specificity of Islam, with the issues of Islam, including violence. Violence is a topic. We can't say there is no issue with Islam here in France and probably in the US. Our idea is to tackle the issue knowing the cultural roots of France. Of course, the answer will be different in France and in the US and in Germany. In Germany, the issue for them is, Turkey will run Islam. It's not our problem, it's a Turkish problem. It's no longer possible. And in France, it's no longer possible to rely on North African countries. We have a new generation. We have to invent a new management, but also a new face. A new face which is compatible with French values. Like the tremendous tradition, the tremendous turmoil of Islam right now is linked to the tremendous turmoil of Arab society, which are inventing something between tradition and their modernity. They are inventing their modernity. And Islam is a part of their modernity. Islam is a part of the French modernity. We have to invent it.
I think we could go on for another 2 hours, and I'm sure you'd agree that this was a tremendous panel, and I thank the three speakers.